Okay. Okay, let's get this party started. There was a question about those credits on an online portal. Quick insights. There was a question about can I see all this? I don't care to see you. Randomly just pick someone. Let's pick Harold. So I can actually go in and say, look here, manage items or manage credits. Yeah. Look at the profile and basically say, hey, you're in or out. So this is how I created assignment 4, your online part. I look, basically I can see here what you have done. I can actually open this up, yeah? I can even go inside and say here in the file sheet the piece. Yeah?
You're a spy.
Even no,
if it's
this
not
is...
shared, you can see it. All our files, even if you don't share it, you can see it.
Yeah, but this is, you know, this is the super boss, and you guys know that a guy called Friedrich is logging in all the time, not Thomas. This is seriously, this is only for creating purposes in that last assignment. Yeah. It also meant that I actually had to look up the student ID number to find your username and look at that. And if you look at the Excel spreadsheet, the online section was the last item I did. Yeah. And because you actually created the Business Analyst Online Map, the PDF file, that was already actually assessed through the PDF before I even went online. Yeah. And I do invite you guys, for every assignment, every creating sheet I give you, if there are questions, ask. Yeah? Even if that's just a comment like, oh, data is not here, or physical classes. There's no physical evidence that you did the work. Sometimes I have maybe missed that. Yeah? Completely okay with me. I usually go through this, and this is my big screen, have different windows open and go step by step. If the physical file is there or if that trace is there, like, I do recommend, but we're done with this assignment, but I strongly recommend for other classes, if you have instructions to save everything in a folder, save everything. If you let's say geocoding. If you geocode 15 times, then keep those 15 attempts. Don't clean them out on just by yourself, because this is something you just learned. Yeah? And some of the expertise will come in and say, hey, you actually did it the first 2 or 3 times right, and then you got confused, and then you messed up. Yeah? If I don't see your 15 different attempts, I can't give you that advice as part of the learning experience. Yeah. Don't delete files. Don't delete files.
Yeah, I regret it.
I can't speak for everyone's personal submission, but I can tell you definitely there was, I think, one student, no MXD file, so I couldn't see that they have been in the right order, those feature classes. Have they been in the right color setting? Because you got like 3 or 4 points just for the color setting. Yeah? That student got burnt in points. That was an A-plus quality work. Like, if you look at the pattern of that work. But no physical, no traceable event. If the physical file was not there, but the mapping file showed you did that work, you got partial credits. Not all of them, but you got partial credits. You got even partial credits if you used the demo sites for the buffering process. you demonstrated that you buffered like 1.5 miles or 3 miles around that site. Well, you did the demo, not the project site, as an example. Yeah. There are two or three, let's make this overweight. I have at least two or three students that have 95 and higher points achieved in this assignment. So this assignment really showed follow the instructions, read carefully. I'm really sure, particularly in assignment, what was it, three, if you didn't read it through and then did it, if you started step by step but you'd never read it before, you got speed bumps. I would think probably half of the class did not clip your buffered, dissolved buffer. There was one sentence there, clip the dissolved buffer and save it to your GIS database. Little tiny thing, so you got the, instead of, well, wasn't really looking like Mickey Mouse this time, it was like weird things down here. So the buffers would look like this. This was the wrapper. So this area here would be clipped away. Repeat the step you did for the census blocks on data you just yourself created and do the cookie cutter. I think that was the most missed step in this assignment. And I basically articulate that as in that step was not read by a student, if at all. Or it was a short sentence, maybe the blame was. Don't want to blame. I want to explain where those speed bumps have been. Yeah. And overall, since we're doing here like the final wrap up session tonight, I'm very happy and pleased how this class went. The progress you guys showed is phenomenal. The frustration you built up is equally phenomenal, but everyone who can laugh right now is on the way to better health. Yeah? So that's okay. GIS is solving problems on a daily basis. It's fun, but sometimes you just, it's not working in 5 minutes. Sometimes you have to go back and sketch on a piece of paper your workflow, your ideas. How do you do these steps? And we just scratch the tip of the iceberg of making life complicated with those leaves. But again, I'm happily pleased for, look, 6-8 weeks ago, you never had this stuff installed on your computer. Yeah? You never had the software properly open in front of you on the website or on the desktop. For that, I am pretty proud of you guys. Yeah? I had a few guys coming to my office in the last 10 days, email. Yeah? Don't panic. Remember the first time you walked your first baby steps in Excel. Huh? Now you're doing financial models in Excel and development performance. Huh? Wow. Well, it's the same thing with here. You know how to bike. You're not winning the Tour de France with your current experience, but you're able to bike down the street without falling off the bicycle. Please be honest if you don't know how to ride a bicycle, and I use a different metaphor. Yeah? Again, my challenge, and I hope I have excelled with that and overcome that challenge, was how to make a complicated software for you a little bit more easier to digest. And I hope I did that. And it's important to say this before you come up here and tell me a story about your project, which is also very funny. I had only one or two students coming in, hey, this is what I really want to do. This is the, I'm looking for data here and there. Like a bunch of students struggling with the idea of what kind of data do I need. But the data they needed, they knew. The process and for all the, and the idea of telling the story for the data was a little bit of a hiccup. When I say hiccup, it's not a complicated life. Huh? I appreciate when you send me emails and I sorry, I don't want to be here. You are not. This is part of my job and I love teaching. Otherwise, I would be somewhere else, okay? Fundamental question before we start. This was one of the problems, and I think, Bridget, that was what you wanted to know earlier as well. Do we have one of the supervisors here? When I deal with population data, where would I get population data?
Census.
Census. Okay. Where else do I get population data?
Esri.
Esri. What is Esri? Well, that's stand for us, an Environmental Science Research Institute. No? What is it?
Private company that collects data for regions.
And what do they do?
Publish it.
Sell it.
What's the main product they do?
The software.
Software. Okay. So we have the census. We can find, download the data. We also have Esri, who gives us somewhat the data. Whoa. There's a question if you need to download it.
Right.
So if you do the census, what you usually end up with is you get a bound, it's called a boundary file. Basically, you have all the parcels or census blocks or census tracts, yeah? Mm-hmm. And a table, technically just with an ID, but not your population yet. That's missing. Because what they do is they give you another table for, let's say, 2010, yeah, with an ID number and the population. And then take the ID number and merge them together. It's called a table join. That's something I will give you in the video. That's your Hurricane Matthew. Life gets complicated with this stuff. It's like, what you need to remember here is the so-called unique identifier. It's like your VIN number for your car. In theory, there's only one VIN number for you and that car. You can't say it with your social security number because someone else might use it. Yeah? But the unique identifier. So that census block here, it's called the IDX. An IDX. And IDX, they fit together. And then you have the chance to say population 2010, color me like this. Huh? If I don't have this data management on my personal machine, we have all access to ArcGIS online. So if you say start here with a base map, let me zoom in a little bit here to the Miami area, or where are we right now? Somewhere else. If I go add, we did this in a different way, I can here search for layers, preliminary atlas, add layer from the web, etc. We use this function all the time when we pull the base map. So if I say search layers, I can find everything in my organization, whatever you guys did before. Or I could go here to Living Atlas and could even search for this. I barely see this on the screen. But I can say population. Search. And it'll help me here, let's say populated places or statistical queries. You gotta find this, you gotta explore this. That's a challenge, can't grant it, you know? But now I have census, the census populated places as an example for population. Maybe not yet in that level I really want to see it on census block groups, but something. You know? if I want to show here, let's say in Hollywood, if I want to show that this, the population around that point in Hollywood, that's my new site, and I want to show 10 miles, that's a population of 10 miles, Hollywood. Yeah? I don't need necessarily this. I can go into Business Analyst, yeah? Say this is my site in Business Analyst, and say hey, for 10 miles radius, define the 10 mile radius rings, and give me the market report, community profile, or population profile. Burns one or two credits, but you get three or four pages completely formatted PDF or even Excel spreadsheets. Because if you are living here and you want to know what's X population in 10 miles, yeah, if this is your question, there are ways to do it like this, but we haven't really been exposed to that kind of third basement downstairs data mining. Don't shoot yourself. Too valuable. But Business Analyst Online could help you with that. The community report was part of the assignment 4. It's one of the biggest ones. We didn't build custom-made reports, so one of the videos I hope I get you guys for 5 to 10 minutes on custom-made reports. So you can say, hey, age group, potential spending retail, instead of 10 pages retail, you only get that block you really need, because it's like a little drag and drop. Yeah, but you gotta play with this. Yeah. So what I told Bridget outside, don't think too complicated. Just picked on you, I'm sorry. If you want to know for your market report style project, hey, what's my population from that location in specific distances? Radial distance with those buffer rings. You do not need to put this together. This, just run the report. Yeah? Because if you would be working for, that's too much. Fancy mouse, which actually has a brick in the wheel. This here shows you the population in those specific areas. You can see, okay, we have probably more population sitting here than here. Yeah, by density. Didn't check the legend. Let's assume they map density. Yeah? If your boss asks, hey, for the location in Hollywood we're interested in, how many million people do we reach in 1 hour drive time? Yeah? You gotta run Business Analyst. In our knowledge base right now, we are going to run Business Analyst online. Yeah? Because we don't have the expensive money to put it on our desktop. And we have like 10 or 12 credits in using that. And then, because your boss doesn't want to know how funny this crate this looks, your boss wants to know 10 million people. 1 million. Yeah? For writing your report and your presentation, those ring buffers look great, but they don't tell really the story. The story at the end is here, the X. I'm sorry that you missed last week's class. And know what you're struggling with. Yeah? And I give you the adjustment and the credits for that. Yeah? It's not like I'm sitting there with a big red pen and I'm yeah? Here and there's a yeah, but for final product, I certainly understand that there have been heavy road bumps and maybe sinkholes to get there. I want to show your path. I want to see your path. If you don't have it on the PowerPoint slide, everyone has a chance to present. And even if you only have like a postcard you sketch on the board, I want to hear the story, your ideas, your struggle. Because the second part of tonight's session is I help you to overcome that struggle, if there's still struggle. There are one or two of you guys. They're like, I had the same problem. I solved it this way. Rutzer guy says, hey, this is the other way, it helps you as well. Yeah? So don't see tonight as judgment day. see it as a collaborative research and learning experience. I have not really an idea what are your topics. I've seen one screenshot from Chelsea, so I know something that she's dealing with in the airport. And one map, I think one student had something about burgers or restaurants. So that said, I don't have a fixed list of who wants to go first or last. Now we have enough time. This is more a scouting process tonight. There is no definite checklist of includes XY component in presentation.
Yeah?
Yes.
I can go first.
All right. Well, we have my laptop here and we have the desktop. So what we're going to do is, I think we said 10 to 12 minutes presentation. If you go shorter, fine. Don't just say, hey, my name is Thomas, and I'm done. Yeah. If you keep talking more than 20 minutes, I cut you.
Oh, no.
No, don't get me wrong, There's probably fantastic material out there. I want you to understand that this is, yes, there's a creating component, but this is about sharing your learning experience. Yeah? Sharing your learning experience. And don't worry, this is, I take off the tie, this is a not super formal event. Yeah? All right, Laura.
Can you access my map on the...
I can have you log in so you get...
I don't remember my password. I have it saved on my...
Because you might see it differently than I do. But that's okay.
I'm sorry.
Oops. So you can see what's coming up next for you.
Nice. All right, hi class. My name is Laura Lopez. And where is my other map?
In the description.
I'll go through this first and then I'll go through the...
It's all yours.
So I did an analysis, as you can see, on a burger restaurant. And it was hard to figure out what the story was going to be, but I finally got my data and everything after hours and hours of searching. And this is the story. So a smart capital company requested a market analysis to study the potential for burger companies in either Pembroke Pines or Hollywood area, right? So my job is to figure out what's better for this company because they want to build and open a new burger restaurant. They want to figure out where, what's better and which one, right? And so I went into, I used RGIS to figure out how to analyze this in a map and using data from MSRED. So I have data, I printed all the PDFs and all the data that I use. And the restaurants I use is McDonald's, Burger King, and Wendy's. The map features, I use a base map from Broward County, Hollywood area, Pembroke Pines, and other restaurant locations. I use graduated symbols for the sales volume, and I use Hard Rock Hotel as one of, like, it was a site in the area because it's the closest to tourism and it's a local attraction. So it attracts not only tourists but also locals, and is within 1, 2, and 3 mile radius from Pembroke Heights and Hollywood. So I'm using 3 different burger companies. I'm using Pembroke Pines, I'm using Hollywood, I'm using Hard Rock as a site to just do a radius. I did a drive time analysis starting from the Hard Rock. And here's the map. You can barely see it, so let me
hit escape.
I'll be able to go back to this.
Mm-hmm. And then change to the browser.
Alright, so here's the map. Okay, can we, well, you can see most of it. So here's Pembroke Pines in purple, Hollywood is in pink, Hard Rock is here in the middle, McDonald's is pink, Burger King is blue, and Wendy's is green. So these are locations where these restaurants are in the area. I also did Broward County, so I think I have some outside ones. Here's the drive time. I did 1, 3, and 5 miles from the Hard Rock, which I should have done longer miles, but that's what came out to be. What else? So, okay, so the red is 1 mile, 3 mile, 5 mile. And this is the graduated symbols. It's based on the sales volume for each store. And so then I went to the data because I needed to figure out my conclusions. And the data, I ran a report for market potential based on the consumer behavior for restaurants in Hollywood and Pembroke Pines. And then the number, this is actually wrong. This is like, it's supposed to be like 2,000 something. So basically in Hollywood, Burger King has 2,000, and then McDonald's has 4,500 number of expected number of adults in the last 6 months that goes through those restaurants. So on the report, it shows how many people are expected to go through every single one of those restaurants every 6 months. So McDonald's is higher everywhere. Obviously, it's like the biggest chain company. So McDonald's is bigger in Hollywood and in Pembroke Pines, and is bigger than Wendy's as well. And the numbers are here. I mean, all the numbers came out of all the data that I found on ESRI, and it's all in the map as well. So, back to that. You can't see that.
You can move the window a little bit.
How do you move it?
On the side, move it.
This?
Yeah, it goes on. Yeah.
No, I want to show this. So, this is my travel from the Hard Rock Casino. I did that, I went in there, I changed numbers, I changed the label for Hard Rock. I tried, for some reason, I tried to change it to black and it stayed white. I don't know why that didn't change. At the other ones, I changed to black. Here you can see, I mean, if you open the table, it goes through all of the restaurants in the area. And It has all the information, like everything I ran is there. And I have these two reports here. And I went through every single one, I changed the symbols, I changed the colors, I, you know, went back and forth with everything. So, yeah, that's it. My conclusion is that McDonald's is a stronger burger company for investments in both Hollywood and Pembroke Pines. I mean, compared to Burger King and Wendy's. That's it. That's what we did. Any questions?
I'm interested. Could you, like, tell us or show us how you went about finding all of the locations for the Wendy's, Burger King's, and
I went to the BAO?
BAO.
So I actually, I started here and I couldn't figure out everything that I needed to, because it's a business analysis. So I went to the business website, which is easier. And I just started playing with it. I don't even remember what the steps were. I grabbed a map and I ran reports and,
Your report of people running this, did you do that for the purple area of Pembroke Pines or for the area around your Hard Rock Cafe?
I did it, okay, that's a good question. Because my report was around the Hard Rock. Because Hard Rock is in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I did it because, like I said, it's like a common area that drives people, you know, to that location. So I did it from Hard Rock. That's where I started. And then I went and used both Hollywood and Pembroke Pines to figure out which city, because I needed the story to fit my market analysis.
That's an important point you need to make in your report and
okay.
Even in your presentation, that you ran this around for the buffer zones shown here from your focused area, from the Hard Rock. Because if I look at this and you tell me, hey, Pembroke Pines has X amount of McDonald's sales, it's actually the opposite. It's only some of the Pembroke Pines share of what you see here underneath the buffers.
Mm-hmm.
Because you ran this for
Hard Rock
in a specific distance. So if you look at the top of the report, actually should say your study site, Hard Rock,
mm-hmm.
and then X miles.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
I realized after I ran the report.
Yeah.
It says 0 to 1, 1 to 3, and 3 to 5.
So it's not people in Pembroke Pines in the last
no.
6 months eating X amount of hamburgers. It's people in that blue round area in the last 6 months eating those hamburgers.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
I ran two other ones for Pembroke Pines and Broward County. I didn't think Broward County worked because it wasn't part of my, you know, I was trying to kind of compare, but I didn't know how to do that. So, but then I did run Pembroke Pines alone, and that's how I came up with this part. So it was like separate data, I guess, but it all went in the map, so.
Perfect. What would you do different if you have to do this project again?
I would do more research. I'll be looking for more things to add. Like the report is so complete that it shows steakhouse restaurants. I was looking at just fast food. It looks at if it's a drive-in or not. It's got a lot. I mean, I would have had so many dots everywhere if I would have used steakhouses versus fast food restaurants. And it was interesting. It was overwhelming because a lot of information. So that's why I narrowed it down to just the three restaurants because everybody knows what they are. And I picked the Hard Rock because it was like, it just came up in my mind. Like, this is a spot where I can pinpoint my research.
All right, good job.
Okay, so
who wants to go next?
Yeah.
Want to do it?
Yes.
All right. Just
yeah.
What do you
need to ask?
Welcome to the back.
Ah. F5, hit F5.
There you go. All virtual tricks.
Alright, so my name is Chantel, and I did my project based on like a hotel. So what I wanted to do, like the background of it was basically I wanted to take, do the perspective of like an entry-level project manager working for a developer that wanted to either develop or acquire a hotel along the beach in Broward County, based on the following criteria. Obviously, we wanna do a hotel, beachfront, we wanted to have multiple stories ideally, and we wanted to be in a really good location. So basically, I didn't really know exactly where to start, so I decided to look on LoopNet to see what hotels were potentially for sale that I could use as a starting point, and maybe try to find something either on there or maybe near it that I would find interesting. And then I came across News, which I thought was like a really cute hotel, and that's it with the star. I was hoping for something a little bit taller and more rooms, but I thought this would be like a good start. Okay, so I did some minor research on the property appraiser website, but for the presentation, I'll just kind of go over the basic facts of the site. So a brief background is it's four stories, there are 19 rooms, it is beachfront. They have limited service, but not like 24-hour service or anything like that. And there's a rooftop lounge, and it was newly renovated. So my objective was to get people to want to come to Snooze. Like, if we acquired this hotel, would it be a good investment? Like, how would we get people to come here? So I wanted to do a preliminary analysis on the overall proximity of the subject property to nearby attractions that a target market would want to frequent. It will be marketed to like vacationers during spring break, during March, or just to friends going on a trip that wanted to be beachfront in a nice location in South Florida. If the GIS analysis revealed that the site wasn't what we were looking for location-wise, then we would pass and just look for a different property, but so far, so good. I created a workflow of what data I would need and what maps I would need to create in order to know, get the information that I wanted to get. So I used geocoding, geoprocessing, and I ran several analyses on the site. I geocoded the project site and also geocoded, I hope I'm using the right phrase, geocoding and digitizing, but I geocoded the project site and then I also did the surrounding amenities, just the ones that I kind of Google searched to see, hey, what's in this area?
Alright, let me ask you one question here. So that little star you put on top of the hotel, did you put that on by hand in an edit session? That's called digitizing.
Right, okay.
That's okay.
I'll change it later.
No, that's okay.
Okay.
Geoprocessing is basically everything in that toolbox is geoprocessing. So if you run a buffer, you use a geoprocessing tool.
But when you bring things from the geodatabase and put it on the map here, would you rather from?
Oh, that's just putting it on the map.
Oh.
If you have 100 or 1,000 addresses, let's say in Excel spreadsheet, then you use the process of geocoding to put them on the map.
Right.
But geocoding is a geoprocessing tool.
So I digitize.
Maybe, we don't know yet.
Well, just imagine if this says digitizing and not doing this. So I digitized the project site surrounding locations of interest, nearby streets, and I also created buffers to give some sort of visual element so you could see, here's the project site, and this is its proximity to the attractions. Okay, so I just took a screenshot instead of going back and forth between like the desktop version and everything. So yeah, this is me in an active edit session using the points that I did. The star is my subject site, and then the other points around it were just some points of interest like restaurants, other hotels, and things like that. And I'll zoom out into like a larger picture where you'll see additional sites that I also digitized. So I also did the streets. I didn't really want the black lines on there. I just wanted the names of the streets in a mask, so I just made it zero transparency so you could just see what street it was. You can kind of get an idea in your head if you're familiar with the area of where this location actually is. And you can see that I was in an active edit session. The blue line is just kind of an example of what I did to get the streets on the map. Okay, so I had to take clips of my project site with all the amenities. And you can see on the far right how I got to the clip session. And this is what I clipped. This is one of the clips that I used that had all of the project site, all the different amenities that I have in there. And you can see that I used like the different colors to show you the different types of sites, like the malls, the nightlife, because we like to party, and other hotels and restaurants and bars that are pretty popular in the area. You can see that they're mostly on Las Olas, but there's a lot that are actually around the project site, which is pretty cool. Okay, so basically this shows you, I put the clips inside of a geo database, and I uploaded it to ArcGIS Online because I wanted to do a drive time analysis and a walk time analysis just to see how close these locations are in terms of how long would it take to drive there or Uber there, and also walk there. And you can see that most of the points are within, this is 3 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minute drive time. So pretty much everywhere that you would want to go is within 15 minutes. So that's a pretty cheap Uber ride, so I think that would be a good marketing point. And then the walk time you can see on the far right, basically you can get to a lot of places within 5 minutes of walking. So I think that's a pretty good point. So when you're on vacation, you don't want to spend a whole lot of money trying to drive everywhere. You want to be really close to it. So I thought that was pretty interesting. Okay, so for my results, I ran a business summary, a housing profile, which shows the numbers. I ran a traffic count, which shows the numbers of cars like on the actual map, and then I did a traffic count profile, which is the number of cars on the different streets that are surrounding the sites. And I did this to get a better understanding of how much vehicular traffic actually frequents this area. For purposes of, I don't want to buy a hotel that nobody's ever going to see. You know, it's going to be hard to get there. You want it to be pretty easy to get there. And that area along the street, I think it's North Fort Lauderdale Beach Boulevard, also known as Atlantic Boulevard, sees about 15,000 cars in any given day. There are actually 75 businesses within a 5 mile walk. I learned that from the business summary. There's 13 eating establishments within a 5 mile walk, and there's actually 30 locations within a 10 minute walk, 8 movies and amusement locations in a 5 minute walk, and there's 15 within a 10 minute walk. A little bit of demographics on the area is it's kind of like an older community, 55 and up. The average housing in this area is about 500,000 and up. So, and they're all homeowners mostly. So I thought that was pretty interesting just in case the developer decided that they wanted to turn the hotel into like a small multi-unit property instead of keeping it as a hotel, so that may be an option. So the next steps that we would do is a more detailed market analysis just to go more in depth of the potential of this property succeeding as a hotel if we decided to acquire it. We want to gather the numbers to run pro formas to see if those numbers make sense, because if the numbers don't make sense, then it don't make sense. And then just to do other property and site information gathering, just to create like a more fuller report. Yeah, just to see if this would be a good, and these are all the pictures you see on here are from the hotel. I just thought I'd give you some nice things to look at.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
Questions?
How did you get the data about the bars and the restaurants and like how did you find
out? Oh, I'm glad you asked. Okay, so I'll go here. So on the Business Analyst Online, what I had to do is I had to run it from the walk time one. Is I just ran a summary and business summary was on there and it pulled up all the businesses within a 5, 10, and 15 mile walk. So that helped. And I would have wanted to digitize all of those. So. But that's how I got those cards.
You would have geocoded that.
See, there you go.
Digitizing is nice. You can do that step by step here and there. But if you have the chance to a really good address list, you don't want to spend a full day digitizing. You can write in 5 minutes if you could. Time efficiency. There's more time for coffee and drinks.
So
what?
Did you do that by hand, the yellow dots and?
Yeah. I just kind of picked. I used the Google Maps to say, hey, what fun places are in this location, and I kind of just picked spots, and then I kind of went back and forth.
But again, you didn't use that report.
But I didn't.
You
yeah. That's why I wish I would have known what.
You can download
with how she pulled up all of those points on there. I wish I could have figured that out, but I thought it was fun digitizing. The points that I did do pretty interesting.
Because what happened? They just showed you the address and you just went
they
to
don't
the
show
address.
You.
No, what I did was just Google mapped it. I went to Snooze and then I just typed in restaurant or nightlife and then I basically just put those points on my map on ArcGIS desktop and just kind of
completely fine. Gotta start somewhere. And if you don't know the whole universe, start with the planet and the moon you're familiar with, or the continent, or the neighborhood. There are different ways to do this, for sure. Yeah. But I really like the way you approach this and what kind of hard work you put in there. Congrats. What would you do different with all the knowledge that you have in the game?
Well, I may have took some notes from her book and kind of played with like ArcGIS Online, just a little bit more with the maps. I tried to play with some of the highway maps and stuff, but it kept giving me errors, and I was just like, this late, I'm tired. So that's what happens. I would definitely try to play a little bit more, see what other maps and elements that I could have input into the project, just to make it more interesting.
Wait, you're telling me you're not pulling an all-nighter for my projects?
No, I put in hours. I put in hours to not want to be too extra. So,
great.
That's what I would
do. Let's change the game a little bit. Some volunteer from the other side, please. Always be...
I think it's on the bottom. Yeah, this project.
All yours.
Thank you.
You've got the F5, right?
The F5.
Okay, there. All right, so I kind of approached this like I'm buying a site and I want to figure out what I'm going to do with the site. So I found this on LoopGut. Sorry, when I get nervous, I get a little shaky. I found this on LoopGut, and this one's on in Plantation, Florida, off of Broward Boulevard, a little over 1 acre, and just some pictures in there from LoopGut. So exactly what I just said. What's the best use for the proposed site? I used Argus Online, and the first little thing I did is I added the little feature to like show the location. And I wanted to kind of view the income, but not just the average income, like the disposable income, because right away, I guess I kind of assumed I was gonna do something like commercial or retail. I wasn't gonna put up housing or apartments. So I kind of did all the different colors, like the beige, the white, and the teals. The beige are low disposable income, so they range from like 29,000 to 35,000. The white is like around 40,000 to 65,000, and the teal and the blue are 85,000 or more. So I didn't want to kind of, you'll see I created like two other or three other features for really each of the main parts, because I wanted to do like a low, a medium, and a high, because I wasn't exactly sure how to like do it all. So I wanted to point out that, which one, where am I? Maybe I have to go back. The part that I circled, that little itty bitty square below the big one, is the actual site. And directly in front of it is a low income area. So I thought that was kind of important to know. And then about 8 minutes or less than 3 miles east is the high disposable income area, which I thought was important as well. I kind of played around and I forget if I did this in Esri or I think I did this in Esri, the middle snapshot where you can go from one point to another because I kind of wanted to show the distance. And then I wanted to give you another idea of just where the median disposable income is. So, we already went over this. I guess it's important to know, I mean, I know this area, so it's next to 441, which has like a row of car dealerships, mechanic shops, all this kind of stuff. It's also important to note that to the east of the site is a brand new Super Walmart. So I guess I was kind of thinking maybe I would do like a car service center, like a full service mechanic shop, only because it's, in my opinion, it was maybe the area for it. I thought it was a good spread of the disposable income. So we have the low, of course, in our immediate area, but not too far east or west. It was looking pretty good. And the site was off of a busy road, so I kind of just did a Google search and literally put in the property address and, you know, what car mechanics are near me. And those were the ones that came up. This is the last thing I kind of figured out in Esri before I was calling it a night. And I wish I kind of wanted, I was going psycho, okay? I wish I kind of would have,
it's a common theme,
dived into this a little bit more, because I was able to run like a data analysis just based off a business name, which I thought was pretty cool. So if you put in automotive, all these different options would come up, and then it actually had one like automotive mechanic, and I was like, wow, that's awesome. So you kind of get a good picture, and I created these buffers here. These are all companies that are mechanics within that area. So my idea
may need to have a second look at it to say, okay, this is a good idea to put a, you know, car mechanic shop here. Or I could approach it as competition. They're all thriving there. They're there for a reason. So maybe this is a good area for it.
Are those all car mechanics or are those also gas stations?
No, these are, I should have done like the pull-up so you could actually see the name.
Oh,
but it actually, when you click the little blue dots, it'll tell you the name of the different car mechanics.
Oh.
That's it. That's all I have.
You want to show us your map?
Sure. I'm here, right on. This mouse is weird.
And like you go to.
Sorry, the mouse is like 10 days old.
That's
a problem.
Right,
that's no yet how to run the mouse.
Hold on, I want to go so you can see all the. I can show you anything.
Yeah.
Okay, because I had this delete on me twice. I just want to add that in there and I had to redo the whole map two times. So, okay, this one. I wish I would have known a way to insert what I did in Esri with the pop-up so I could show you guys how I did that.
So you did that in the on the business or this one?
No, the one that had all the locations.
Mm-hmm.
That was like the last thing I found, which I wish I could have explored. But I did that in the business, yeah. Because you can like literally run a search by just putting in a business name and it will give you like all these different choices.
So you can share it and see it here. That's what I did. So
okay,
you
well,
it's there, you can still see it. You just
okay.
have to go share it.
Go back there and share it.
So you can open it here.
Okay.
And you can actually save it back and forth.
Uh-huh.
Between the two.
It's good, yeah.
So you can do the rings.
That was the fun part.
And then save it in your old content area and then pull it up here as a new layer.
Okay.
It's there. If you save it, it's there.
I hope so because I'm not redoing things again.
All right, let me ask you, any questions? What would you do different? After all this trouble and pain now, what will you do different?
Number one, I would save right away, because you're right. People forget to save things, and then you walk away and things happen. Number two, I think I would have maybe started with BAO and really kind of dove into the data there and maybe gone back and forth. But I was kind of concentrated, thinking I had to get the map done. So after I kind of got the map, and then I was like, okay, but this is what I want to do, I was going there secondary, and I wish I would have kind of played
yeah.
between the two areas a little bit more.
Thank you.
Who's next? Since you're starting here to fill up the ranks, who's
I'll
next?
Go. I'll go.
Go for it.
Is there a way for me to connect my laptop?
Yeah, why didn't you? You want to use your own?
Can I try and download
one?
Yeah. I don't know how to save it.
You guys want to do a quick break for so we can fix technical stuff?
Yeah.
All right. For those who are using a pure PowerPoint or something, you can actually load everything here, and then you don't have to take those hours of breaks in between. Yes, I do have an argument on this one because it's the one I use.
Yeah, I looks like they have
so
to be
able
I was able to publish it in open.
Right.
I had to delete one, which I was really upset about.
because, yeah, because I was like, this isn't, like, I couldn't. So I was like, let me start all over again. Because at first I didn't know what to, like, it was so much information. Yeah, it's like, I want to do something in retail.
So if it's online, it's just...
I mean, I want to email them. I should be like, well, I did send an email. but we're telling everybody to double check.
Oh, I was just writing on the slide. Oh, well, how are you? I'm tired, obviously.
Oh, yeah, that's working. You want, might want to move your window a little bit.
Where are we?
I need to get that off. Okay, I'll just move this. So, for my project, I decided, well, everyone knows that sports authority is basically out of business. They have like no sale going on. So what I decided to do was to choose a particular site or location and then think about what would work really well there, being that there's just so many vacancies. So what you can see on this map, I did this actually all from the online art catalog thing or ArcGIS. And these are just the locations that are currently in Broward County or used to be in Broward County. So there's a few in Pompano, there's some in Cold Springs, Hollywood, Pembroke Pines, Sunrise, which is basically Sawgrass Mall, used to be Sawgrass Mall. But these are just the Broward County locations, and I kind of just tapped that in. So for this section, I just decided to do like a little ring around the my subject site. So it's a 1, 3, and a 5 mile ring. As you can see, the closest one to that particular site is kind of like outside of the 5 mile ring, so they don't really build up as closely next to each other. But I meant to tell you fun facts about Sports Authority. The first one actually opened up in Lauderdale Lakes, which is pretty much that site. They had about 450 stores, but because of bankruptcies, Dick's Sporting Goods actually bought out some of their leases. And if you type in Sports Authority, Dick's Sporting Goods actually comes up instead. So for this, I did a 1 mile buffer. Within my 1 mile buffer of my site, that's my site entry center, about 26% of the population, their income was about from, let's say, 0 to 15,000 a year. But the second highest amount ranges for over terms of what the population of that particular area is bringing in for it. So this is the site, as you can see, if anyone pretty much knows where that is, it's North Federal Highway. It's about 4 acres when it was a store and they actually had, you know, customers coming in. It had about 49,000 square foot of leasable, gross leasable area, so it's a pretty big store. Across the street or beside it is actually the Barnes & Noble. Across the street there's a Whole Food. There's pretty much a lot of traffic within this site. It's actually about 50,000 cars that goes from North Federal to each intersection of the street. This I found was very helpful because you just type in the particular site that you wanted, and if you click on it, it actually tells you what they spent in retail since 2016. So my site right here is the little dot, as you can see. Let me see if I can zoom in. But the darkest shaded area shows, you know, the most that they spent. Can everyone see this number here? That's pretty much across the site. And then on the actual street of the site, this is about 173 . So that this is probably one of the reasons why I chose this particular site, because in comparison to everything else, the darker shaded areas, they're pretty much spending a lot of money within that one strip of North Federal Highway. So this was all the online.
Just a minute. They're not spending that area, that amount of money in that area. There's a reason why those areas exist. Those are probably census block groups or something like this. So there's a specific area for other purposes, and the amount of money spent is just in that area.
So this is a retail within this area.
So for that specific geographic area, yeah. Be careful with what's the boundary and what's the message of your data. Yeah.
This I decided to do a drive time. It's 1, 3, and 5 miles radius of the site. The reason why is just to show how close it is to various intersections. It's not even 5 minutes from the beach. The walking distance is pretty good as well. It's legit, almost 5 miles to Victoria Park, which is pretty common in Holiday Park itself.
So.
Okay, so when I was thinking about different locations or what would work well at that particular site, I decided to just find out what sites or which locations around there had to do with sports. I was thinking about doing another sporting tenant, but down the street or across the street actually, Dick's Sporting Goods is actually there. So this just gave me an idea of everything that's within the area or close by that has to do with sports. So here's Dick's, which is across the street. There's a few sporting restaurants. This is a ball sports park. This was just to give me an idea of what's out there in terms of sports. So what I did finally come up with was thinking of maybe putting a fresh market there or an open air market. So I wanted to look around and find out what other stores or other things similar to the open air market within the area. So these are all the food sites, the grocery stores. As you can see here, across the street is a Whole Food Market, which is an indoor facility. These are pretty much all the food and markets place. So from my side, to put a full conclusion on it, from my side, I think the best for this space would be like an open air market. There's a few in Miami, they're mainly in New York, you can find them as well. But it's just like a flea market, but higher end, so there's fresh foods there, there's RC things of that nature, but it'll just be a free open space and it'll blend in pretty much with the environment. To the east of it is Coral Ridge, north is Lighthouse Point. They're pretty good areas with decent income as well.
What you were saying, those block groups, the retail spending, what was that? Like you said, it wasn't in that area?
No, it was, But you can't just, you gotta be careful if you look at that. And
right.
You said that's where people spend a lot of money. And you need to be really explicit that this is where people spend as a representation of the retail sales in that area. But
right.
That I would think. Looking at the boundaries of your areas, that's actually block group.
Okay. So are you saying that I'm representing it incorrectly? Because it's just saying that this
no,
is
No, I always said that you have
to
be careful how you formulate that statement. Because next time, if this could be disposable income, as an example,
mm-hmm.
and you mix those in between, this would, if you by accident say this disposable income, that would mean that people have a lot of money to spend, but this is the location where they spend it.
Okay.
So the dark shaded blue strip area, that was in fact the retail sales for that specific area.
Assuming dark colored area is a high volume spend on sales, yes.
Yeah, so like here's the breakdown.
Block
group. Let me see if I can show you. So, I mean, I don't understand what you're trying to say that I didn't do, but it's showing you that the black portion or the darker shaded area, this is how much they spend. So
what?
Not saying that
retail?
In retail, including
that's
food
that's
and
all
everything.
That's all I wanted to know. Okay.
So that's pretty much it. This is all from online.
I really like your presentation. How did you, what kind of program was that? Because you have
no,
I like how
it's
on the top.
No, it's actually from this. If you go here,
presentation.
You just say presentation and it kind of creates
where?
A presentation.
Where?
I saw that, but I didn't want to click on it.
Yeah.
So like, if you go to my
I didn't want to, run the risk of losing.
But like, you choose whichever one you'd like to use. So like, let's say I'm going to use my messed up one.
Okay.
And then, that was really the messed up one. But on this side, it would basically say presentation, create a presentation.
Nice.
And then it kind of just creates the presentation.
Oh, I see.
So it says open
there.
Presentation. And then it creates it like this for you.
That's really nice.
All right. What would you have done if you would have not access to internet tonight?
If I did what now?
If there would be no internet tonight.
Like how would you have presented it?
That is 100% internet-based presentation. So you gotta make sure that you're safe in terms of backup.
Right.
Like screenshot all these wonderful slides.
Or
and put them,
screenshot
is good enough,
and
screenshot them
down
into a PowerPoint.
Right.
And have
just in case.
PowerPoint
export,
and.
Can you export it?
Yes, but it would make it life simple, screenshot is faster. Mm-hmm. But just make sure that next time when you do a presentation, love the interactive component, love it. But if you do presentations, you need to know what technology you are dealing with. Same thing as in. Do I actually have my, if I present on a Mac or Apple, do I have the adapter to run on the presentation podium, that projector or not? Probably not. Gotta have that little tiny cable connector. Yeah? So always make sure that the equipment you present on is running. Worst case, literally, track your own laptop with you. But then you don't really know if you got that connector or not. So Dropbox helps if you have internet. They have a PowerPoint somewhere, but the USB jump drive is a really God-given helper.
Did anyone else
I like
have any
it
questions?
What would you do different? Lessons learned.
I probably would have, breathed a little and not stressed out as much because I really know. But I mean, take a deep breath, and I probably would just spend a little bit more time in organizing my thoughts and everything else. But I think I did pretty okay.
You think? Finally, you learn to breathe and to be calm. Good.
I told you I'll breathe on Thursday, so I'm breathing now.
Alright. Good job. Who's next?
I'll go next. Can you help me put in my computer?
Sure.
Anybody else?
So we have a jump like ready to go.
Yeah, go ahead. I'll go after.
So when I started this project, I approached it from a how can I use it to solve a particular question that I've always had, right? I want to start building houses. So my big thing is, okay, where do I start building houses? Or how do I, where, what area do I go and get into real estate development, right? So it occurred to me that for me to find out where the hot spots are, basically, I should probably see where other developers are developing, right? If I'm gonna build a residential house, I wanna know where there's a lot of activity. I also wanna know where there's a lot of rehabs going on, because that means that it's a changing neighborhood, right? So I thought that the first step to this would be for me to get building permit data, because building permit data says a lot. First of all, it tells you what's getting demoed completely. It tells you all the permits that are getting pulled. And it tells you who's building new houses, right? So that's one piece of the puzzle. The next piece of the puzzle is going to be for me to break this down into neighborhoods, right? Because as many of you know, this Miami right here is really not just Miami. It's actually, there's a ton of different neighborhoods within there. So first thing that I did was create this layer here, breaking it down by neighborhood. So I'm gonna zoom in and show you. So as you can see here, for example, Coral Gables, right? But right next to Coral Gables, there's a nice little neighborhood called Silver Bluff. Over here is the roads. Up here, Grapevine, all these places, right? So the question then becomes, how is it that I can really dig down and get the data points of what's happening in all of these little neighborhoods, right? So first thing, what do? We go ahead and we bring in the permit data. Obviously, this is after it gets geocoded. We can see here three things. Let me show you guys.
You actually finish your geocoding.
Yeah, this is after you finish the geocoding.
Well, you finished your data set of geocoding.
Actually, yeah, I did. But I did it. I ended up doing it another way.
All right.
I'll explain later if you want. So I want to show you guys something. So once I got that permit data, I filtered it big time. Okay, I broke it down, and the yellow spots, all these little yellow spots, are for rehabs going on over the last 12 months. Okay.
Of course.
Yeah. So watch this. So the red dots are new construction, and the green dots. And this is all, by the way, this is all filtered for the last 12 months. The green dots, however, those are demolitions that just happened over the last 2 months. So that tells me that, you know, somebody bought something there and they cleared it out, single family home, they probably tore it down, and they're gonna be building something there, right? Now, the problem with this, as you can see, is that it doesn't really tell me anything. You know, I mean, it sort of does, but it doesn't really tell me much. Because of the concentration, right? I mean, you could really drill down and check it out, but the first thing that I started doing was summarizing this, right? So, if you guys remember from our class, this right here, just visually tells me where's the most development going on. And as you can see down here, this is the biggest spot. That's actually where a lot of new development's happening. So like if I zoom in, it shows a lot of activity. You see that? It's like 800 houses being built around there. Now, you know, that still doesn't really tell me though, because what I want is some insight as to where should I really go to, right? So the next thing that I actually ended up doing, and this is what actually took me a long time to figure out how to do this, is to create an analysis, a hotspot analysis, using summarized data grouped by each neighborhood. So for example, this is now when you start to really see visually where the really hot areas are. So this is for the rehabs. These particular neighborhoods, and if I overlay the neighborhoods, it'll start to really tell me, okay, I gotta drill down in here. This is all for rehab. There's tons of rehabs happening in these areas here. This little corridor right here. Little area over here. So those are for rehabs, and then I did the same analysis for the new construction. And this is like where tons of houses are being built. Now,
you did building permits for a single family residential, or did you differentiate by type of housing?
Yeah, actually, so when you download the building permits, you can really drill it down a little bit and differentiate it by commercial, residential, what sort of building permit they're getting, value of estimated repairs or whatnot. I mean, you can really drill down. I mean, there was a lot of SQL filtering behind the scenes there to really filter it down. But you know, it could be filtered even better. So yeah, I mean, this is pretty interesting because, for example, this will tell me where I gotta go, where I gotta start looking. You know, your marketing dollars to try and find some deals are gonna be limited. So you have to specialize. Now, you can really drill down, and then if you overlay the block group thing, you can focus your marketing down to the block group level to try and find properties around there to buy. So that's that. Now, questions?
So how did you get all the building permit data?
Yeah.
Building permit data is provided by Miami-Dade County.
Okay.
Yeah.
So would you put it in like a CSV file and put it?
Okay. So basically it's a huge data dump. It comes down, I mean, you can export it however you want, but yeah, I export it down in CSV. And then I import it into an SQL database, start massaging it, cleaning it up, filtering it down. And then you import that data, and then you import the data into ArcMap. But then the key is you have to also, so to answer your question how I ended up geocoding this, I also went to the Miami-Dade website. They actually are really good about providing data, by the way. Mm-hmm. And I downloaded the entire shapefile for every single property in Miami-Dade County. And then I did a join to assign to the permit data the X and Y points. Then I imported that into this thing right here. And with this was very important that this layer right here, this top layer is actually pretty important because with this, it lets you pick and select every single little feature that goes inside of that particular layer.
So you think Bay Area is the hottest area to do something?
Well, I mean,
did you make a decision?
this comes down to the question. Are you looking at the area where is the most rehab activity and building activity, or are you crossing this over with where is the most sales and transactions going on?
Yeah,
and
so
then are you actually taking the leap and going into the gap between areas where rehab and sales are not yet big enough but show potential? Are you taking that risk, or are you jumping into a pool where everyone already is sitting in there and with their blow up toys and having a party? Or are you digging a pool and know that all they will come to your pool?
Yeah, well actually, I mean, that's a good segue into that question of what I would do next. I'm gonna tell you, I actually have a list of things that I'm going to do to this. It's going to be the following. Look, first I'm going to add another data source, which is the MLS data. It's going to be essential to add the data source for the MLS. Why? Because you'll be able to add days on market, average square foot per value for each little segment. I would probably even drill it down a little bit more, because some of these neighborhoods, you know, you go one block over and it's like, even though it's pretty broken down, you can probably still subdivide a little bit more. So yeah, once I layer the MLS data on top of this, I'll be able to know the square footage per square footage, be able to know days on market, I'll be able to know the high values and the low values. I mean, I'll be able to get a lot more information out of that. But more importantly, to get even more accurate here, I'll probably subdivide it further, categorize it more, right? Not only that, but I'll probably come up with ratios. So for example, I'll be able to say, okay, in Palmetto Bay, there's 500 houses, and yeah, granted, maybe 20 new construction and 20 rehabs. But analyzing the ratio, I'll be able to compare neighborhood by neighborhood to see where there is a lot more activity, right? Because maybe these neighborhoods, it's, yeah, there's 1,000 houses being built, but hey, there's like 10,000 houses in this particular neighborhood, you know what I mean? So, I don't know. That's another thing that I gotta work on. The other thing would be also to create the space-time cube to track it over time and be able to do emerging hotspots. To really be able to track, where it's going.
You already got that.
Huh?
You already have that. The building permit should have the.
No, you do have it. You do have it, but I gotta add that additional time layer to be able to track the. All right, I'm gonna tell you one more thing I'm gonna do.
Go ahead.
This is like essential. I'm going to take all of this and put it on an online database, a query layer on top of it, so it's all automated, and then figure out how to get all that data source dumped in there on a daily basis, so I don't have to do this manually ever again, and create a report to get it through.
Wow. So, Harold, how did you actually fold the geocoded locations in? Like, did you have a catalog, create a table, or like, what?
Okay, so, let's see, basically, you do the spatial join here. I mean, you're going to go over this, right? How to do the...
You do the spatial join for that?
Actually...
Pop up your data open. Come on. Can you move the window a little bit so we can see actually the full size?
All right, let's see. So these are...
That's your polygons.
Yeah, but see, like, you know, I would add the...
Which data dump is that?
Hold on. Now this is after being filtered a long time.
So how did that get changed in action and maps?
Good question.
Okay.
Did you do it in catalog first? Like, do you create a table?
Did you go from Excel and then into catalog?
No, he obtained it
no.
from the county.
Oh,
right?
You download the data.
No, I download the data.
Which is
and I upload the data in here. You create a. You can import it here, but you know I use SQL, so it's a little easier for me to kind of manipulate it a little bit on the outside. But yeah, you can bring it in here, and then you can start adding other attributes. So for example, let me show you.
Jump in here a little bit. The SQL, the structured query language. So when you do the select statement, select land values equal or smaller than 100,000, this is SQL on its lightest version. This is like a grain of sprinkles on your wedding cake. Yeah. So he basically is using a system which is a little bit more sophisticated, takes a little bit more play time, but it's really cool because you can do a lot of stuff actually without even a map. Remember when I told you 4 years in Cincinnati and made only 4 maps? All the other stuff is basically database management and running code. So you could literally go in here and say without a map, just in a data table, don't even use GIS for it, just in a big database, you can search for X, Y functions, fields, sort fields, etc. That's
a pen. Yeah, and I mean, look, it took me a bunch of steps to do this, you know, like, I mean, look, you got to summarize the data, like, look, you got to summarize the data here, so for example, here you have all the neighborhoods.
Geocoding.
And then here you have it broken down, you see? But each one of these layers, they contribute something, like, you know, these little numbers right here, they essentially link to the, to this layer over here, to the map. So yeah, no, I mean, I think the best thing about this assignment was that I really, 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 like, dug deep into it.
Good. Who wants to go next?
Well, we need to drop the mic.
Nobody else is dying to go.
Go, go for it.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just gotta plug it in, right?
Yeah.
I'm not going anymore, I want to get it. This is giving me a scare.
Everyone has a chance.
Going after him is like.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You look good.
Until Harold go in.
Make it short.
So tell you a story about this. Oh, I'm not going after this guy. So one of my coolest conference presentations where I was like, yeah, this is really changing the world, or at least part of the world in that state. The president of that professional organization was